thank you for listening this morning so far. And I just want to carry on with the story. And as I pointed out to you, we'd had 2 years of failure on my own farm when I turned back to God and lost everything, and then went to this widow's farm. And the first day we were there, from October 1982, that first season, was another failure. 3 years in a row, we lost money. And so the Lord was really starting to knock on my heart. And we were on the verge of being closed down at the bank, and somehow we managed to survive another year with the widow to have one more season. They said, last chance. And so this widow had a farm in trust to her only son. I didn't own it, but I wanted to safeguard it for them. And so I was very concerned about the situation. I didn't get fired myself, by God's grace, but I had to go and ask God, what is the problem? This is farmers losing money for many years in a row, to the extent it's going to be sold up now. And so I started to look around, and I saw that we were burning all our crop residues off. You call it trash. And here, trash is something we throw away in the dirt bin in the British system. But the crop residues, the trash. And so we were burning it all off, and then we come in with plows. We were taught that you must plow deeply and evenly, and we had big John Deere drag plows, which were the deepest five disc plows, and 100 horsepower tractors belching out lots of hydrocarbons into the atmosphere, turning the soil over. And we had a fine grain, schisty type of soil, and it was getting harder and harder. And each year when we came to plow, we would bring up clods the size of footballs or bigger. And then we'd have to come in with 2 or 3 harrowings and rollings to try and break it down to a tilth that could be planted into. So our costs were going up and our yields were going down. And a great deal of loss through use of diesel and spare parts and repairs and maintenance and so on. And we were going out of business. When I saw this, I'd heard about zero tillage, which had been developed in the Dust Bowl and had been practiced on a small scale throughout the prairies up into the Great Plains, into Canada, and then it went across to Europe, and then to Australia, to South America over the years. And then in the 1970s, 10 years before this happened, it was brought into Africa, and they chose Rhodesia, which is the name before Zimbabwe, as a test case place for the kind extension people from America to come and show us how to do this. So they brought the technology in, and 10 years before this drama was going on. So when I heard about it, I thought, I'm sure there's something good about this. This must be the answer. And so I went to see the experts, the academics, the research people, and the extension people, many of them PhDs. And I said to them, what about this system, zero tillage, that's been practiced in America for so many years? And they said, oh, no, we tried that 10 years ago. It doesn't work. We're in a tropical environment. We've got lots of land. We haven't got the machinery. It's not necessary for us. We tried it. We gave it to a few farmers to try, and it had failed. It doesn't work. So I was quite disappointed because I had a feeling this would be right. So I was wondering what to do, and I couldn't get any information. It was the days before the internet. We were just emerging from our bush war. We didn't have machinery. We didn't have any information or anything. Nobody had any experience of it, and the academic community didn't want to even share with me. Said, don't even try. And I was concerned about this. And then God started to intervene. And one day I was reading in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 22. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because he has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools. So the summary of that really, that hit my heart at the time, was that if you look at God's natural creation, you're without excuse. There must be a God. It's just impossible for it all to have happened without the Creator God. And it says there we'll see his nature and his ways. So with childlike faith, I decided to go and have a look and see how my father farms in nature, in creation. I'm trying not to use the word nature because the unchristian, ungodly greenies use nature as the excuse. It's actually God's creation. Okay, I'm just going to practice that in my own heart because I've learned about this greeny thing since I've been here. So I went out to some virgin bush on our farm. We call the woods that you call the woods, and the English people call it woods. We call it in Australia and in Africa, we call it bush. And it was lovely wooded grassland. And I went out there, and Jesus says, I only say what my father says, and I only do what my father does. So I went out and I had a look at what my father does. And I saw that the leaves fall down on the ground and the grass dies down. And there's a beautiful blanket over the surface of the earth. And then I noticed that there's no soil inversion, deep soil inversion, in natural creation, in God's creation. And so I thought to myself, if this is the way my father has farmed the natural creation all this time, surely it must be the right way. It doesn't die of compaction or lack of nutrients, disease or pests or drought. It's survived and it's flourishing. So I just looked at this and I thought, well, if this is the way my father does it, surely it'll work. So I just want to show you the process just now of how that grew. But I just want to go and now explain to you the technology very simply, and because this is how we teach the small-scale people to feel the story and to touch our hearts and to show honor to God. Now, here is a picture of a diagram of an experiment that was done in KwaZulu-Natal, it's a Sidara Agricultural Research Station. And it was a simulated storm trial. They took two pieces of ground, and this is one of the pieces of ground, right next to each other. And on the first treatment, they put a simulated storm on of 63 millimeters in 30 minutes. And that's a typical storm we get in Africa, especially in the early season, on a 4% slope. And so here's a picture of the rain droplets coming down from high up. And in actual reality, what happens is they reach terminal velocity and then they hit the ground like many, many hammers. Like, and you know, you demonstrate it to the people like this to get them to feel it, like a panel beating. And the impact, it releases kinetic energy. And it now hits the soil and actually pounds it and creates a soft crust on the surface, smears it. And when we plow, we think we're being very wise. We're leaning on our own understanding. We say, let's plow, because if we plow, then the soil's all nice and loose for the water to go in and the roots to go down. But we don't go and ask God. We just use our own understanding. Because I just want to say that God says in Scripture, don't take your hand back from the plow and look back. So he talks about plowing. But what for my studies, it was a wooden frame with a spike that really broke the fallow ground. And that's not dissimilar what I see in nature, creation, sorry. And so what I see is in Africa, we have the wildebeest migrations in East Africa and the springbok migrations before they were shot out in South Africa. And it's just an example of how God deals with the plains of Africa and your antelope in this continent. But they used to go and migrate, and there would be dust clouds coming up. You could see it from many, many miles away. And when they'd passed, the soil had been shallowly tilled with their hooves to a shallow level. So I see that in God's creation. And it's quite amazing that why did God make the antelopes have quite a heavy body mass and weight, and yet they had very sharp, small little hooves. And those hooves are what tilled the soil, but also because you've got this blanket over the earth, a seed has to touch the soil surface. It's been designed to absorb moisture, to swell and grow and to germinate. And so what happens is the seeds fall on this blanket, and then the animals come and push the seeds down into the ground. And that's God's planting mechanism. And so it was just giving me ideas. And then the birds come and scratch and get the seeds down to the ground, and there's a dispersal of seed, and enough comes up to continue the process. And God is so wise. So a small amount of disturbance is okay if I'm going to follow what my Father does in his creation. But in this case, man comes along and thinks he knows better than God, and he starts to go deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. And I just want to show you what happens when you do that so we can convince our people. And so as it pounds this surface, the water starts to move downslope. And because you've now buried all God's blanket, because when you plow, there's this inversion of the soil. You turn it upside down, and the blanket that was there is now buried in the soil. And you expose it to the elements, to the sun and the wind and the rain. And there's no protection. So now it seals the surface, and it slows the water. There's no friction there to stop it, and it gains momentum and gets faster and faster and faster and runs off. And then they measured how much water was lost. And they found that 90% of the water ran off the surface. And that meant that only 10% went in. And they measured that carefully. And then the next thing they did was to measure how much soil was lost. And 28.5 tons of topsoil per hectare, that's 2.5 acres, was lost. And when I teach the small-scale people, when we teach them, I normally draw a big, one of those 24-wheeler big, we call them lorries, trucks and trailers full of soil, just to show them how much is lost. But the sad thing is that it costs us over $300 per hectare to plow. But then there's another drama that happens. Now here, so we've spent money to lose our water and our soil. Now here is right next door is another model where there's no plowing and the blanket is on the surface where God meant it to be. And so the raindrops come down from high up and hit the surface. But now there's a cushion there that God's put there. And instead of pounding like that, it hits the cushion. And there's no impact onto the surface. There's no sealing of the surface. The friction of the biomass that's there, the residue, slows the water down. And then what God has done is he's put many little beetles and worms and ants that live there. That's the habitat that he made. And they eat that, and then they take it down in little channels into the surface, into the soil. Earthworms do a wonderful job, as well as a combination of them with different sort of little roles to play. And so what happens is this water now, it slows down and it infiltrates down through these little channels. And so now they measured how much water was lost. Instead of 90%, only 6% ran off. And that meant that 94% went in. So we're now capturing God's moisture that he's given us and not wasting it. And then they checked how much soil was lost. Instead of 28.5 tons of topsoil, in a heavy storm, only 1 ton of topsoil was lost. And it didn't cost very much. But across on the other side there, you see there are two horizons in the soil. There's the aerobic horizon that's closer to the surface, and because of God's way of his structure and the little channels, oxygen and air gets down into it. And then underneath that is the anaerobic horizon that the air doesn't get to. But in this horizon, this level, are many little aerobes. They are fungi and bacteria, and they need air to live. And underneath them are different species that don't need air to live, but God's put them there. Now, the biomass, that the residue that's on the surface here, and here you have the previous plant that gets knocked down to become your blanket. The little beetles and worms take it into the soil, but it's still not in the form that the plants can use for food. It has to be mineralized. So God's put these little creatures there to ingest it and excrete it and so on, and they mineralize it so it's in a form as food. But then man, and he's leaning on his own understanding, comes along and turns that upside down, and most of them die. And we're actually killing God's fertilizer factory. So then we have to go and buy expensive synthetic fertilizers out of the bag, which costs lots of money, and our poor people can't afford that. And just to show them that this is God's way. So, and also, what God has done is these roots stay in place. When you plow, you destroy that root. We call it the root anchorage. It holds the soil from washing away laterally, but also holds the soil up from slumping downwards, so it never gets too hard. Just amazing what God has done. And so we call this God's wisdom. And the other model, we say, is the foolishness of man. Just to, you see, because as we teach, God says to us, trust me with all your hearts, don't lean on your own understanding. Acknowledge me in all your ways and I'll make your path straight. So at every opportunity we can as we teach, we point to God and the designer and the Father who's personal, who loves us, who is all-knowing, and who wants to impart knowledge to us and show us the way. And he says that my son is the way, the truth, and the life. And through Jesus Christ, we have been freed to receive through the Holy Spirit what God's way is, and to understand it and to do it. So it's a very simple picture. So I didn't see all this before we embarked on this adventure. Later on, I saw it confirmed, but God was speaking to me in my heart. So I thought to myself, if my father does it, surely it'll work. So now I didn't own the farm. It belonged to the widow in trust to the son. So then I decided I must go and have a try. And I prayed to God for wisdom of how to do this. Because you see, no information. I hadn't been to college or university. I'd done a bit of physics, chemistry and biology at school, just enough to understand the basics. But I didn't understand agricultural science as such. And I praise God for that, because I was able to go and ask my father how to farm. And so I went and I sat down and I said, Lord, these are your plants, this is your soil, will you show me how to do it? And then he gave me some wisdom of how to try, and we planted some maize into wheat straw. And so we did it very carefully, because I realized that this process had been given to some farmers to try 10 years before, and it had failed. So I thought to myself, I don't want this to fail, Lord. Perhaps it failed through a half-heartedness, an unwillingness to change. And so in this, I took 2 hectares, which is 5 acres, and we had 1,000 hectares, we were still plowing, 998 hectares. But I took 2 hectares and I got permission to have a try. And I did it at the very highest standard possible, every tiny little detail, which was to make sure it wouldn't fail. And it was another building block to teach into the people standards and management and how to achieve those things. So it's all emerging in the story for the 4 people to understand. And everybody said, oh, it's not going to work. You're crazy to even try. You know, we tried it before and my neighbors are scornful and they said it's not going to work. But we did it and God gave us faith to try and at a high standard. At the end of that season, we got 20 tons off 2 hectares. And so here's a picture. I hope it's coming up. No. So there's 2 hectares. And we did it very well. And we got 20 tons off 2 hectares, which is 10 tons a hectare. Now that's an acceptable, normal yield in America at the moment here. But our national yield was under 0.5 ton a hectare. So it was 20 times the national yield. And so it gave me great encouragement to try again. And so the next year, we did 50 hectares, doing it very well and training our staff. Meanwhile, 950 hectares were still being plowed. And the next year, we did 100 hectares. And that was so successful, the next year we did 200 hectares. The next year was so successful, we did 500 hectares. And after about 6 years, the whole farm was down to it. Our yields improved enormously. Fuel use reduced by 5 times, down to 1/5 of what we'd been using. Our draft power, our repairs, expenditure reduced. And we grew 3,500 hectares with far less power. And here's the transition picture of in the far distance burning tillage and then no tillage in front of us here. There's a picture of the fruit of that wheat field. Ground us. We were breaking yield records in all these crops, and God was just blessing us, and we were winning national farming prizes. Sugar cane, that's a gigantic sugar cane. We, without tillage, we were getting 256 tons a hectare of cane, and in South Africa they work on 90 tons a hectare. But the amazing thing I can share with people in Africa, and maybe everywhere, is that when we started with this 2 hectares down here, 998 hectares still being ploughed. But that year, that farm made the first profit for a number of years. And the lesson that's coming through now is that God says, if you read the parable of talents, he says, if you're faithful little, I will add to you. If you're unfaithful a little, I'll take it away from you. And you see, sometimes we have a gigantic problem or quest, solution in our hearts, like to change a continent, to change the moral index of a continent. He says, just go and be faithful a little. Make a model that I will multiply. Because here's a story of what's given me faith. Now, not to be afraid of any scale, because our God, there's no giant too big for our God. And he adds to faithfulness. So he's teaching us these values and principles in our hearts that we can teach our people because they don't understand these things. And we, Craig described to you that we've been so unfaithful with our land. Our national yield has remained just under 1 ton, actually declining slightly, whereas the rest of the world have doubled. America from 4.5 tons to over 10 tons annually a year as a national yield. Remarkable. And you are sitting here through the faithfulness of the first thing God gave you, which is the land. And I just want us all to know that farmers are important because they are the stewards of the first thing God gives any nation. And it's so important to be stewards of that, because why you are so prosperous and successful over these years of God's grace is you were faithful to the first thing, then he added signature industry, manufacturing, mining, service, and so on. That hasn't happened in Africa. And the travesty of Africa is that the rest of the world runs Africa. All the big businesses, the big agriculture, the big mines, all run by others. And it's very dangerous, and I'll try and explain if I have time later on. So then the story doesn't end there, because it was the beginning of our collapse, of a slow sort of decline in our economy to a degree that unemployment was rising and food was short. Although we were holding our heads up in terms of our dollar value at the time. And the prices were brought right down by government. They started controlling the prices. We were having drought seasons, and our neighbors were going out of business. And so we started to buy the farms around us for the trust for this young man who was still at school at the time. And by 12 years after this beginning here, that farm became 3,500 hectares, 8,500 acres of food growing annually, net area, 1,350 hectares of wheat under irrigation, because we don't get rain in winter and we have to grow wheat in winter there. And the amazing thing is that for the moment we turned to God here, we made a profit every year after that. And so God was teaching us about profitability and consistent and sustainable profitability in our own terms. But now, when this happened, I felt God say to me, well, firstly, he showed me something. You see, when I arrived at this farm, we'd lost everything. We had no money. And we had a very low salary. And then, as I walked around, people had heard a Christian man, a white Christian guy, had come into the area. There were a few ladies at a Bible study, but no Christian men around in our area. So they were very poor, and they would come to me and ask me for help. And somebody had no shoes for their children to go to school in. They couldn't afford to send a sick child to the clinic. They couldn't pay their labolia payment for their wife, which goes on while they've got children for many years. And the parents of the of her, the wife were going to take away the children. And they had all these burdens and suffering, and I saw the poverty of the people. And I couldn't say, just go away. I had to listen to it. But when I said to them, I haven't any money to help you, they wouldn't believe me because they thought that all white guys had lots of money. So I used to agonize in my heart and say, Lord, these people are so poor and I can't help them. And I talked to my wife, Kath, and I said, what can we do? And so we prayed, and we thought, oh, well, you know, God says if we seek him first in his kingdom and his righteousness, he adds everything to us. He said, if you trust him, you know, see how he feeds the birds of the air and clothes the lilies of the field, and how much he will do it for us. So we thought, look, we haven't got any money, but if we bring the gospel, then that's the way we can bring them out of poverty, because of God's promises. So we decided to start to have a little session, and a lovely old American missionary came along with his guitars and his few guys, and we started having services in the midweek in the evenings, and then we started to preach the gospel to them, and we built a house for a pastor and employed a pastor with our own tithe money. Our bosses weren't Christians, and then we built a church, and we brought them the Salvation Gospel, and quite a few came to know the Lord progressively onwards there. And then we started every day in the morning early with prayers and before work. So we were sharing the gospel. But the thing is that, as I think Craig shared, and is that the salvation gospel has gone out for all these years, but the people in Africa are so very poor. And I realized that there was a problem. So then God said to me, I've given you this technology for them, not for you. So I thought, okay, how can I share with them? So I realized that discipling is actually a modeling process. Paul says, follow me as I follow Christ. We're to try and be like Jesus, that and be like him and model ourselves on him. And so I thought it was a modeling process, and this is God's way, I believe. So I went and took 1 hectare, that's 100 meters by 100 meters squared, and I prayed for wisdom how I'd do it if I was a communal farmer with a hoe. And it was on the road access into the farm near the river, and the communal area with all the tribesmen on their little farms were across the river, and they were very, very poor and very, very hungry. And so I decided to put this model in, and it grew beautifully. It was a tall, beautiful maize with no ploughing, and it was amongst our machine planted stuff without ploughing. So it looked very beautiful. And so I had a big field day, and 150 of the people from Chiweshi across the river came, and I wanted to show them that you don't have to plough to make things grow, because they thought there was something essential and magical in the ploughing operation. So we had a meal for them and cool drinks and Cokes and things. And then took them out to the field, and I said, you see how this beautiful crop here, there's been no ploughing, and you don't have to plough to make things grow. And then they looked at this and they said, oh yeah, but there's something magic about you white guys. It won't happen across the river where we live. And so I thought, well, they haven't received this. So the next year, they appointed one family to be a model. So we went across with our fertilizer and our seed and our labor, and we put in 1 hectare, 100 by 100 meters. Quite a big piece in their context. And it came up absolutely beautifully. 100% stand, even dark, about this big, and no ploughing, a bit of mulch there, God's blanket. And I said, now you look after this, because I want to come back at the end of the season to yield test it against your ox-ploughed plots around, to show you that you don't have to plough to make things grow. Understand the experiment? Yeah, sure. And so we got very busy in big farm. We went away. And we came back, and when we came back, it was a jungle of weeds that had been completely abandoned. And I couldn't understand this. Second year we've been trying. And the ox-ploughed plots were very ordinary, but not very good, but they'd looked after, and there weren't so many weeds there. But this was just abandoned and never touched again. So 2 years in a row we'd lost it. So I tried another person was brought forward to try another farmer and his family, and the same thing happened. You know, experiment, come back and check it, abandoned. 3 years couldn't bring the first truth to them, and God had told me to take it to them. But with God, time is another value. We don't fully understand it. But so I had to go and pray and said, Lord, what's going on here? And then we did a survey, and we took some of our people. We had quite a few Christians on the farm now, and we went across to find out what had happened. Now, what happens is that in Africa, it's the poppy syndrome. What happened is this family had received real favor, because we said, here's our fertilizer, our seed, our labor. It's all for you. Don't have to pay us back anything. We just want to do this experiment. And it came up beautifully, and everybody else's crops were very not beautiful at all. And so when it flourished at the beginning like that, they all got very jealous, because now they were being shown to be inferior. And it's a great problem in Africa. And when I make this statement, I see professors and church bishops and leaders in Africa nod their heads and say, yeah, that's our problem. Jealousy is a great problem in Africa. And so that is something to sort out. But how did the black people, those lovely indigenous people, how did they deal with that jealousy? So what they did is they went to the witch doctor, and they got some what we call muti. It's some feathers tied around with a bit of bark or something like that, and a curse has been put on it, and they recognize it when they see it. And they brought it and they put it in the corner of the field. So along comes the family, so excited about their beautiful plot. Wow, this is beautiful. And they get ready to hoe and they see this. And they get such a fright, terrified, because it's got a curse on it. If they touch that plot now, one of the family might die. And they get so debilitated with fear, they don't touch it again. So God had to show us that, you know, there's a massive spiritual war going on. Ancestral worship and witchcraft is rampant across Africa. And in the churches, it's a sad thing to say that so many will go to church on Sunday, but when the tough time comes, they run to the witch doctor. So endemic is this fear inside. And you see, Satan rules by fear. God rules by love. And fear paralyzes your instincts of inspiration and productivity and inventiveness. And I just have to say, I'm an African, I live in Africa. Very few inspirational inventions have come out of Africa. And so when God sets us free, it's better. So I realized that there's a great oppression on that. And it's so rampant across Africa. And we've preached the salvation gospel, but we haven't discipled them fully and truly. So you see, there's nothing that has defeated that system. The author of that is the evil one himself. Because it says in Deuteronomy 18, it says, it's abhorrent to God if we speak to the dead. And we can't speak to the dead according to Lazarus and the rich man. So they're not speaking to the ancestors. They're speaking to demonic impersonators who've watched them, and they can just say, oh, your grandmother buried some, or their grandfather buried something behind that tree or something. And it just locks them into this whole system of fear. And so now, there's no army, there's no philosophy, there's no money, nothing in this world that's defeated the author and of that and the perpetrator of that, which is the evil one and his demonic host, but the Lord Jesus Christ and his finished work at the cross. He defeated the power of sin and death, the power of Satan and his demons at the cross. So the world's system of aid comes in with all these NGOs, and they're humanistically orientated, sadly. And man is our God, basically. And we don't turn to God. And they come in with all this aid and all this aid, and they don't come and deal with the spiritual side, because man is made up of mind, spirit, and body. They deal with the mental and the physical aspects, and they fail, and they fail, and they fail. All this aid of $2 trillion is not... And when they withdraw, it goes back and drops down again. So we realize we have to go forward with the gospel, primarily Jesus and his finished work to deliver them and set them free, because he came to set us free. And so that's a very important part of what we've learned. And so then, because of this and jealousy by going to one individual, we had to now go and share with more people and obviate that. And God went before me, because a local headmaster of a primary school came and said, will you come and teach our children? So we went and did the same 100 by 100, 1 hectare plot at the local primary school. It came up beautifully, and there was no jealousy because they all shared in it. And we taught the children the principles and so on. And it was lovely to hear them in little dramas and skits at their speech day, when I was invited to give out the prizes and so on. To hear it coming back at us. And then the other headmaster saw it, and in a very short time we were in 5 primary schools and 4 secondary schools, and it was amazing. And I was excited, because if you teach the little ones in the way they go, they won't depart from it. But sadly, because of the intrigues in our government after our Bush war, as it went up the level and the school inspectors took it further up, it got snuffed out, because there was, sadly to say, the white guys had to be, the economy was declining, and we had to take the brunt, and everybody blamed us for it. And so it didn't go very far. But it was a principle of going to groups of people rather than individuals, we learned. But then the next way God introduced this is that what had happened after our Bush war, which had been supported by the communists and so on, and there were some socialistic countries like Scandinavia who'd supported them as well. After the Bush War, there was no land appropriation from us at that stage, but the Scandinavians came in and bought some land and then recommended a cooperative system. Collectivism is this, one of the things, showpieces of socialism. Put them in cooperatives of families of about 50 families on a big farm of, say, 600 hectares of arable land. And then they gave them working capital as well to grow the crops. And they didn't understand Africa at the time. And so what happened is that these cooperative people would look at this money and see, oh, that's there. But they suspected each other. So they all took their share quickly. And then they grew a few hectares of maize on this big farm. And the cooperative system was failing very dismally. So the Organization of Commercial Cooperatives of Zimbabwe, which had been set up as a parastatal in the nation, they came and asked for help. And so I came to see my wife, and these guys were all ex-combatants who had been in the Bush War. And I don't know if you know the communist system is they indoctrinate the people to hate the enemy and all that sort of stuff, you see. So they really were indoctrinated to hate white folk. And so when this happened, and I went to Kath and I said, you know, these ex-combatants have asked me to teach them. She said, where are you going to teach them? I said, here on the farm. She said, where are they going to stay? I said, with us in our house. She said, what? Those guys, they've been indoctrinated to kill us. It'd be dangerous. So I said, no, you know, if our enemy's hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. But if he doesn't know how to farm, teach him how to farm. And the word of God touched her heart, and we started to teach them. And she's a very brave lady, and she fed. There were 12 bristling with hatred, these guys, and they came. They couldn't look at us. But their seniors had sent them along to learn. And 12 of them stayed in our house, and 30 in a tent outside our front door. And Kath fed them for 2 days while I taught them. And it's amazing when you go and do something against your flesh like that, how God comes and works. Because it was an amazing time of testing and loving those who persecute you. And amazing softness came, and relationships started. And then we were asked to go and teach in 58 plots all over these cooperatives and put in these demonstration plots in 58 places in the next 10 years. And in all provinces, in all soil types, in all natural regions and rainfall areas and so on. And we learned a huge amount of adopting it in different situations. And but there's something that happened, is that every time we went and we taught with our little team and for 2 or 3 years and supervised it, when we left, it would collapse back to nothing, 58 times. And I said, Lord, this is the problem with Africa. We can't translate theory into practice. You see, there are interventions for all these problems in Africa and in farming that would go, fill a bookshop would go for kilometers probably, but we don't do them. And so I thought to myself, how can we overcome this? And I prayed. And then the Lord started to show me, because I had to ask God and say, why is Africa the poorest continent on earth getting poorer? Because you see, God is omniscient. That means he knows all things. He knows everything. He's totally all-knowing. He knows how many atoms there are in the universe, probably how many quarks there are in the universe. I'm sure he does, because he's all and in all. He made them all. And so if that's true, he knows the totality of every problem, the totality of every solution to that problem, and its implementation plan. And so if you go to God and he says, I want you to be like Jacob, who didn't let the angel go until he got the blessing. I want you to be like the importunate widow who went to the judge and wouldn't let him go until she got her verdict and nagged him and nagged him. He says, I want you to be like that. I want you to ask me, let me go. Be wholehearted, not half-hearted. He wants to see that sincerity of heart, of seeking his face. Turn from your wicked ways and seek my face, he says. And so then in Scripture, he says in Jeremiah 29:11, I know the plans I have for you, not to harm you, but to give you hope and a future. You see, God's all-knowing. He's got a plan in his heart for everybody and for everything into eternity. We're to join him with what he's doing and say, what are you doing, Lord? Can I join you? Not go and do our interventions or ideas and then ask him to bless them. Say, what are you doing? This is the simplicity of what we should be doing. So I decided to just said to God, you know why Africa is the poorest country on earth. It's in your knowledge base. Please show me. And he answered me in a strange way. Not what I expected. He said, there have been violation of two scriptures as a base. Other reasons, it's not that simple, but this is the foundational, very important part of it. He said that it's the violation of the parable of talents. I've given this continent so much land and resource, but we've been unfaithful with it. And so this is the stuff that I taught Craig and they teach others now and how it arrived. And so we believe in our hearts when we go out to teach it where it came from. And he said, they've been unfaithful. It's washing away and our yields haven't improved after all these years despite better technologies and hybrids and all that. And he said, I have to take it away. I cannot add to unfaithfulness. You see, God is a holy, just God. If he makes an edict in the parable of the talents, he can't make an exception. And so it's unfaithfulness. And the second thing he said, Africa is unselfish. And it's a hard thing for me to say to African folk, but basically you see, ancestral worship and witchcraft is so fear-based. And Satan just rules by fear. And what happens when you're exceedingly afraid for your life? It heightens your self-preservation instincts, which heightens your selfishness instinct, your selfishness. And they don't tithe, and they come inward-looking for themselves. And so it's a generalization with a few exceptions. Of course, God's grace, and there are exceptions. But as a widespread problem, so it's unfaithfulness and selfishness are the first two things he shows me. And so then I said, okay, Lord, that's why. But now how do we bring Africa out of poverty? And so I wrestled with him. And he said to me, so the hunger map that Craig showed you. Now, this is what God, I said to the Lord, Lord, how can we get Africa to come out of poverty? And he answered me in a strange way. He answered me and said, teach them to make a profit. Seems strange to me in profitability. But the truth is that we're losing money at every level, from the small scale to medium scale, large scale, national scale, continental scale. And we're losing money at every level. And the only alternative to a profit is the begging bowl or theft. And you meditate on it, there's actually no other way. And profitability is essential for survival and sustainability and growth. And I thought at first, oh, it's all about money, it sounds like unspiritual. But it's actually the fruit of faithfulness. And that's how you've grown in this nation, is the profitability that has been necessary. And sadly, there's a massive debt burden on you like us now in Africa. So then I said to the father, I said, Lord, okay, we have to teach Africa to make a profit, but it's not happening. How do we teach Africa to make a profit? And then he said to me, there are three things you must teach people to make a profit. Everything you do must be done on time. Don't be late for anything. And the second thing is, do everything at a decent standard, at a high standard. Standards are important. And the third thing is, do it without wastage, with a minimal wastage. Eliminate waste. It's so simple, but if you do those three things, invariably you'll make a profit. Now in Africa, we're always late. I don't know if you've been to Africa. If you call a meeting for 9 o'clock, you're lucky if it starts at 11. And then our standards are the poorest in the world by miles. And we waste so much. We waste time, energy, labor, water, opportunity, on and it goes. So those are the causes of our poverty. So there they are, and that's what brings profitability. Now, the problem is that you've got to translate theory into practice. And we have a very simple management system, at least a technical system, a very simple technical system. A person with a hoe can farm, and the standards they can achieve is amazing. A person with a hoe can be the best farmer in the world. I've been on 3 study tours to America in the earlier days, and I would look and see these great farmers and stuff. And I looked at their lines, and you measure them. Some plants are 11 inches apart, 10, 9, 8, but it's averaging so and so as they drop. But with a hoe, you can be absolutely precise, and you have to put your fertilizer in a band, whereas this way you can put in a dollop immediately underneath the plant where the roots will get it quickly. And you can achieve the best pattern of accuracy and stand and everything with a hoe. It's not a second-rate technology. So so now we always later, standards are very low, and so it's possible, but we've got to translate this theory into practice, which doesn't happen in Africa. So I said, Lord, how can we do this? You know, we tried, and it doesn't work. And you've got to have a breakthrough. And what's your way, Lord God? So he said to me, well, without vision, my people perish. Now, what is vision but what God sees? It's his vision. And he sees the problem, its solution, and its implementation plan. It's part of the vision. He's got the answers in vision. And Jesus is the hope of this world applied to life. So without vision, my people perish. So it applies to salvation and to discipling. And my people perish for a lack of knowledge. Knowledge comes from God. What is his plan? What is his process? So we have to share what God sees. So there we have the people unable to put theory into practice. And you have to get that knowledge into their hearts and not just their heads, because it's not happening from their heads. You've got to get them in the belief system where they really want to do it. So I said, how can we do that, Lord? So he says, well, you have to share the story with them, the vision, what I've shown you. And you need to share with them how I brought you out of poverty and turned your farm around, our farm around, where I was working. And you share this vision with them so they can receive it in their hearts. And so then he said to me, when you go to them, you have to get them to listen deeply. So much teaching goes out, but it doesn't reach the heart. So I said, how can you do that, Lord? And he said, well, in Luke 6:38, it states there, as you measure, I will measure to you. Okay. So if you show generosity, God shows it back. It's just a spiritual law. If you share kindness, you'll get it back again, and so on. And if you trust him. So he said, now you want them to listen to your story. If you want them to listen and open their hearts, you must just simply be like a child and go and do what I say. So you go and listen to them first. So I teach our teams now, which are expanding in many places. Go and listen to the people and say, how are you? Now you pitch up. You see, not many people have time to listen properly to people, especially very poor people. You want to go and take them, your interventions, and tell them, I've got the answer for you. They don't hear your second sentence. Satan makes sure of that. But also their hurt and their complexes and things prevent them. So we go and we say, how are you? And we've come here and we acknowledge God straight away. We say, we're here because we love you. They don't understand that, but and God's given us a love for you. You state it, they might not understand it, but it's a truth going forward into them. So then they look at, and you see, we arrived in a motor car, so they think you've got some money. So they tell you, they think, oh, if I tell them all of my suffering and problems, They might feel sorry for me and give me some money. So they start to pour out their problems. They pour them out. And we just listen with empathy and listen hard, praying for discernment and so on. And they pour it out. And you empathize and they see you listening and they pour it all out. And then when they're finished, they've got it off their chests, we say in English. They've told you their story. And you say, yeah, we're so sorry, but it's like Peter and John said, silver and gold we have none, but what we have we'll give to you. So in our case, we haven't got much money in our nation. Our nation's got no money. The churches have got very little to tithe with. And we battle for funding where we are. Sometimes Craig has been such a hero to keep us going. And our team sometimes goes for 2 months without pay. Poor people who are teaching have so died to self that they carry on teaching and despite that. But we don't have any money to really help them. So we can honestly say to them, you know, well, I don't have any money to help you, but, you know, then I tell them my story and others tell them the story now, that once I was very, very poor and lost everything, and then God showed me how to come out of poverty. Now, you've listened to their story, so would you like to hear the story? They love storytelling, so they say yes. If you go in straight away and start to try and teach them, they're waiting to make you feel sorry for them, and they don't hear you. But once you listen to them, it softens their hearts, and God's promises there in Scripture, as you measure, I'll measure to you. You've listened, so they will listen back. It's that simple, applying the gospel to life. It's a tiny thing, but it's important. It's a lesson in our hearts. So it's just one of the ways God has shown us. So then we share the story in story form, and it's more dramatic and than I've shared with you, because they love of that. And they see the hope of a person who lost everything, who turned to God and acknowledged God. And we point to God all the time and the Lord in our story, acknowledge Him in all our ways. And they hear the story and how we sought God's face. He gave us a technology and a management system. And then we finished the story and they've heard it. And then we go to their field. Now, they've heard it, and they still haven't got much faith yet. But we go to them, we see this field, and it's a jungle of wheat. It looks terrible. It's a failed crop. It's unscruffy and untidy, and it's just failure and defeat. And these poor people are hungry because they're not feeding themselves, and so their diet is not good. They're not well. They're in captivity to poverty, so they feel hopeless. And they've got no self-worth. They think we're the bottom line of everything. And these are the people you go to. And so now you've got to bring them out of this depth of poverty. And so then you say to them, you see this field now, we want you to plant into this without burning and without plowing. And they look at this jungle of weeds and they say, impossible. And I would too, quite honestly. You know, it's just impossible. So then we say, okay, now, remember the story of the 2 hectares in the corner? Let's go and make a little corner of your field and we measure 2 meters by 30 meters. And we put 4 pegs in and we put white string so you can see it, stick white string around. And then we take a piece of paper or newspaper. Now that is a right angle. If it wasn't a right angle in the printing machine, it would clog up. So it's a right angle. It's a very cheap set square. So we go into the corner and we teach them standards. So we put it down like this, and then we line it up with this string here, and we say this way, that way, that way. Oh, yeah, that's it. It's exact right angle in one corner. This end is 2 meters, that end is 2 meters, this is 30, 30. So it's a perfect rectangle, just one corner measured. Takes you 20 minutes at the most to do. But you're teaching them standards and precision for the first time. Very simple. And then they line up with their hoes. It's a husband and wife, and a couple of children, and a grandmother or widowed aunt. And so they shoulder to shoulder across 2 meters, and you say, now chop down these weeds at ground level, along a straight line along this, the edge of these strings. Chop it down, and that's God's blanket going down. You've told them the story and you're describing it. And as they go, the grandmother goes behind and spreads into an even carpet behind. They chop, chop, chop. After about 40 minutes, they turn around and they come back again. We leapfrog the string over another 2 meters. They come back, chop, 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 chopping down at ground level. And the mulch has gone down and the grandmother's spreading it. So then you say, come and have a look now. Have you seen a combine harvester that goes through a wheat field? It's got like two walls of wheat. And it's all nice and spread at the bottom if you've got a spreader behind your combine. And so they look at this and they see this box. There's a jungle of weeds all around in chaos. And they see beautiful order and this beautiful rectangle and a lovely even carpet spread. We say, doesn't that look lovely and beautiful? And they say, yeah. And then you say to them, you know, when God designed the temple, and if you read about the designs for the next temple in Ezekiel chapter 40 to 46, I think it is, there was precision, exactitude of measurement. The walls were measured. There was an angel with a measuring cord and a measuring rod. And it was measured, and even the alcoves and the thickness of the walls and everything, precise. And then God anointed the craftsman with the Holy Spirit to make it beautiful and stuff. So I said, God loves beauty and orderliness. He's an orderly God. So we're pointing to God all the time. And I said, this is shining, you're giving glory to God now. It looks beautiful. And you've just done it in less than 1.5 hours on the first morning. And you've just done something. You're 2 weeks before the rain comes, you're on time. The standards here, no machine on earth could do it better than that. It's a very high standard. And you know, you're not wasting anything. Because that mulch on the surface now is stopping evaporation of your soil moisture. Those plants are no longer taking out fertilizer and nutrients. And you've put the blanket down that feeds God's fertilizer factory. And I've explained it to them. And they understand it. Funny if they're intelligent. If you just love them and show them. And slowly do it. And it's amazing how they receive it. So I say, you know, you're feeding God's fertilizer factory. You're not wasting anything. You've just been on time, at standard, without wastage, with a small piece. And remember, God says, if you're faithful little, he adds to you. You know, we started with a little piece and we made a profit for the first time. God is faithful. He's got no favorites. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He'll do it for you because he can't break his promises. And I've seen it happen in my life. So they see this. And they look at this, the beauty, and the story, and the truth. And you know what happens in their hearts? The first time, a little bit of hope comes. First time ever. They've had no hope before that. So they see this. And of course, remember the Holy Spirit is there working, because you're praying for them, and you're honoring his word. And our God is faithful, if you're faithful. So you should share with them. And then a bit of hope comes. And you know what follows hope? Is a bit of joy. Fear makes you fearful and destroys your joy. And you know, Nehemiah, if you read the story of Nehemiah, those walls were built in 52 days. Removing rubble, building the walls under siege from Sanballat and his cohorts, hanging gates, 52 days, a construction engineering miracle. Through unity and focus, sure. He managed to unify the people to all do it together and to focus for a season. The priests, the women, the priests, the Levites, the perfume makers, the silversmiths, just an example of some, set aside their tasks to go and for a season to rebuild. It's a lesson for us to rebuild your nation morally. Anyway, we'll come to that later. So, they see this and then this joy comes into their hearts for the first time. Now Nehemiah says in chapter 8 verse 10, he says, our joy was our strength. So suddenly from the hope comes joy, comes a bit of strength. And they start to do the whole thing, and the whole piece is finished. What was impossible, looking at a jungle of weeds, no plowing and no burning. A miracle has happened on earth, in Africa. So, it's so simple and so small, but you listen, you love, you listen, you bring hope and joy. And the truth, sharing vision. So I'm sharing with you at a very low level, but these are principles that apply to any gigantic endeavor. It's amazing. Now, what happened is that I was very excited about this process. And we've seen amazing success at the very bottom like that. But I thought to myself, now I'm leading on my own understanding. God's got to teach me some lessons now. I said, Lord, this is amazing. Imagine if we could tell our president or our minister of agriculture. It would be wonderful. Then they will teach the nation. Please, can I get to them? And so God looked down and he saw this funny old farmer and he must have chuckled. He said, I've got to teach him a lesson. It's a funny way God teaches his lessons, because about 10 days after that prayer, I got put on the Agricultural Research Council of Zimbabwe. Now, when I went along to our first meeting, I learned that our mandate was set up by government to go and look at all the interventions and systems in agriculture and look at all the problems and then put them together and relate them and come to government and make recommendations for policy to government. Exactly what I'd asked for. And I was made chairman of our provincial council, which meant I sat on the national council. Now here I am, never been to university, and I'm chairman of this council. Outstanding, astounding that a white man was given that place. Like I thought, Lord, you're in action. You've answered my prayer in such a short time. And I was surrounded by black PhDs in agriculture, in agronomy, veterinary science, and the different hydrology and these things. So these very important guys, and I'm their chairman. So I opened in prayer, and I'm so excited now. I must tell these guys, and we've got this mandate. Oh, Lord, you're amazing. So I get out the green book I'd written at that stage with the three different levels, from small and largest growers, and all the principles that I'd learned at that time. And so I gave them all a green book. I said, this is the answer. And they looked at this. They saw I wasn't a doctor, and doctors only read doctor stuff, and what is a white, simple farmer, what has he got to know? They wouldn't read the book. And I was chairman, and we had to go around and have a meeting every 2 months, and we had to bring a report of what we saw, and we used to go on field visits with these guys, and we were going around, and they wouldn't hear, and nothing was happening. I thought, Lord, this is just crazy, Lord God, you know, I'm not getting through. So then one of the guys on the National Council was an ex-teaching professor from the university. And his gardener came to him, a poor gardener, and he lived in a nice house in town. And he said, I want to leave my job as a gardener now, and I want to go back to my homeland, we call it a musha, and start farming. So the professor said, okay, all right. He was a seed breeder, actually. So he said, here's a bag of seed, and just go and do what this book says. He hasn't read it. And there was a Shona version, so off he, it's a local language. So off he goes. He goes down 100 kilometers south of Harare, and the chief gives him a very ordinary piece of ground. The chiefs allocate land to the people. Not very smart, anything. And he's very poor, so he builds himself a little bush house out of grass and poles. And then all he's got is a couple of hoes and a bag of seed and stuff. So he looks at the book and he reads it and he sees, oh, I must measure, and I must do it very accurately and chop the weeds down. So he starts obeying what his professor boss, ex-boss said. And so they're doing this, and all the people are laughing at them, saying, where's your plow? You're crazy. You're going to go bust. You're mad. And they scorned them like anything. But somehow, by God's grace, that's all they did that year. Not a very big piece, but they did it. And then they come back to Harare. And they go to this professor and they say to him, come and see what we're doing. Now the professor thought, oh, I've got a national council meeting coming up, agricultural council meeting, and I'm supposed to have reports. So yeah, I'll come out on the weekend. So he goes out, and on the way to his ex-gardener's place, he has to go through many, many of these small-scale farmers. And there's been a terrible drought, and there's no food. And he's going past there, and he's looking, and he sees nothing, and he's feeling so sorry for them, and he's taking notes. He's having a look and say, wow, he's getting more and more depressed. And eventually he arrives at his ex-gardener's place, and he sees a beautiful crop, the only one he's seen. And he says, what have you done? He says, don't you remember this book you gave me? What? He looks at it. And he comes back to the counselor and says, you better listen to this funny old guy. But you see, the lesson is that God taught me something. You will never change a nation or any institution from the top. When Jesus came, he refused the kings, the governors, the powerful, the educated, the rich. He went to 12 ordinary poor people, uneducated, and changed the world. Because they have the humility of the Lord to be able to listen and to do it. And he says, I choose the weak to shame the strong, and the foolish to confound the wise, the are-nots of this world. That's who he chooses. Do you understand how different it is? How we Christians can understand these things that the world will never understand. They're trying to do it from the top. This pride will not. Are they asking God? Or would they listen to God? So in the next session tomorrow, I'll share how God showed me more on this great adventure. So, you know, it's been simple. It's a story. But I just wanted to share with you because these things have to penetrate the heart of a people and a continent. And God's different way is amazing. And we can trust him with all our hearts. So thank you so much for your patience and kindness. It's a simple story from a simple guy. But God's genius is his simplicity. Thank you so much.